Hi everyone, welcome to this week's course video. This week we're going to talk about judges and a movement within literary criticism called structuralism. So just to give you a sense of what structuralism looks for, what types of questions they ask, and how this may or may not be helpful in our examination of the biblical text. So in this video we'll talk about what structuralism is, whether it's important for our reading of the Bible, and if so, how, and what are some of the common critiques of structuralism. So what are some of the ways in which people after this movement have said, you know, really this isn't that helpful. The beginnings of structuralism starts, I would say, with the advent of a field of study called folklore. And this might be an academic field that you're not that familiar with. So just to briefly go over what happens in the development of folklore. Folklore begins with a couple of brothers by the last name of Grimm. So Jakob Grimm and Wilhelm Grimm. They were two German academics, and they lived in the 19th century. Excuse me. And they traveled around Central Europe and they talked to ordinary people that lived very normal agrarian lives, and they asked them to tell their folk stories, their fairy tales, their common stories that they told children, and they wrote them down. And they went to one place, and they would ask questions about their stories, and then they went to another place not so nearby and they would ask the same questions, and they compiled these sets of stories. And this first the set of stories was first published in a German work that in English would read something like Children's and Household Tales. So this is the early part of the 19th century, and you're probably familiar with this collection, loosely speaking, from, I don't know, your past or watching television or something else, but you probably have heard of the Brothers Grimm. So when they analyzed these stories, they would look at elements of orality, repetition, traditionality, and mythic elements. So what I mean by orality is that there's a certain way that stories like this are told. And you probably are very familiar with the fact that many of these stories begin with a phrase similar to, once upon a time there was, you know, X person or X situation. So when we hear the word once upon a time, we sort of know what we're getting into right away, what kind of a story it's going to be. And many elements of these stories, though, came about prior to them being written down. So there's something about once upon a time that helps you get started telling a story, if you're just telling a story. There is repetition in the sense that many stories follow similar patterns, similar elements. Somebody starts off, they get into trouble. There is somebody comes from the outside and resolves the problem, and everything returns back to normal by the end of the story. There's also repetition within the story. So many folk tales contain sets of three things. And I'm trying to remember if your commentators talk about this. I think at least one of them does. And oftentimes, stories have sets of three. So if you think about, I don't know, any garden variety kids story, I don't know, Goldilocks and the Three Bears, there are three beds. So this is a very common element in stories that are told orally, are these sets of three. We try to think of a Bible example, we can think of the Good Samaritan. So in the Good Samaritan, there's a priest passes by the injured Israelite, there is a Levite that passes by the injured Israelite, but then on the third try, a Samaritan passes by and he stops to help the man. So this is a common structure in oral stories. And in general, there are themes that I've just sort of labeled traditionality, and these could be all sorts of things. Children getting eaten in stories, or the threat of being eaten alive. There's people being lost and then recovered, good triumphs over evil, those types of traditional themes that come into play in stories. And there are also mythic elements. And when folklorists talk about myth, they use the term in a different way than we would probably commonly use the term myth. So you might hear, you might click on some ad on the internet that says, 7 common myths about dieting. And when we think of a myth, we think of a story that we've thought to be true, but it's actually false. And that's not the sense in which folklorists use the term myth. When they speak of myths, they're speaking of a story that is traditional that explains why things are the way they are. So in a very broad human sense. So why do humans do X thing? And then there is some mythic story that explains that. Then in 1910, a couple of scholars, one by the last name of Arne and one by the last name of Thompson, published a classification of stories that's still used today. So they took what the Brothers Grimm did and compiled their own stories, and then they classified them by story type. And people that criticize this say, well, how do you, isn't this classification kind of artificial? But it does help us see that there are many stories across cultures that have the same elements. So stories about, again, people being eaten by wolves. That could be one of the story types in the Arne Thompson classification. Or pulling swords from stones, or people slaying dragons. So there's all different kinds of classifications of stories that seem to be present across cultures. And through this classification, they identified the fact that many traditional stories share common elements. So this is what we mean by structuralism. We look at a story, we see a particular structure in the story that sounds familiar, that seems similar to what's going on in other stories. And when we look closely, we see these common structures. Let's look a little bit more closely at what we would generally classify as hero stories, which is what I want you to focus on for Samson this week. And in our article, our little excerpt from Alan Dundas, he looks at past scholars' lists of traditional elements of hero birth or birth/youth stories. So if you look at a traditional hero story, what do these stories have to say about the hero's birth? And he compared a few lists, and while the lists were not exactly the same, there were some common elements among hero birth stories. And because he compares, he notes these same elements in the story of the birth of Jesus, he got into a lot of trouble, had a lot of death threats, but that's sort of beside the point of what we're talking about here. He's just looking at what some common elements of hero birth stories are in folklore. So some that we might be familiar with, again, just to sort of pick a few. The hero is abandoned at birth and then maybe set adrift in some way. The hero is saved by animals or lowly people, so usually shepherd people of some kind. The hero later discovers his true royal identity, so often it's a royal identity. And then there's maybe some sort of revenge on the hero's father or the people that abandoned him originally in the story. So among many other things, Alan Dundas identifies these elements. So if we look at these elements and we compare them to, say, the Moses story in the Bible, we would find that there are many common elements of this in the Moses story, but also some things in the Moses story that sort of subvert or upend these elements. So we see, first of all, a hero being abandoned at birth. I don't know if so much abandoned exactly, but Moses is set adrift in a little basket on the Nile, and he's discovered by the princess of Egypt. His parents, or his mother and his sister, are sort of waiting in the wings. But there's something common there, too. People have noticed similarities between this story, and there's a story by about Sargon the Great, who's set adrift in some sort of box on a river as well. So there's other stories like this as well. So the second element, saved by animals or lowly people. So the Sargon story, he's saved by shepherd people. You know the story, perhaps, of Romulus and Remus, the founders of the city of Rome, who are raised by wolves. But here, the Moses story is subverted a bit in that he is, instead of being raised by lowly people, he is in some sense raised by Egyptian royalty. So it's really just the opposite here. And then later in the story, the hero discovers his true royal identity. Well, in the Moses story, he discovers his true identity, but it's not a royal identity, it's an Israelite identity. So it's sort of just the flip side of this particular story. And then finally, there's some sort of revenge on his father. I don't know if I would call this revenge, but in the end, the Egyptian royalty that raised him, maybe not the exact same people, but the same household, is ultimately subject to the plagues and is punished for having enslaved the Israelites. So we might say that the Moses story somewhat roughly follows this outline, but it also subverts this outline. And you might even, some people have gone so far to say, is that really the people that we think of as royal are actually the slaves, and the royal identity is the one that is subverted in the story. But we might see some common elements there. So if we take this idea about birth stories or hero birth stories, and we think about common elements of biblical birth stories, we might, using the same process, come up with a similar list. So oftentimes birth stories in the Bible start off with situations of infertility or sterility or some sort of complication to conception. Then there is an annunciation type scene. So this doesn't happen in the same way always, but a prediction of birth by a divine figure. And this is an element that we see in the Samson story. And in the Samson story, it's really interesting because it starts off, the messenger of God seems to be just a regular human messenger. But by the end of the story, he seems to be a little bit more divine than what we're used to. So some sort of an in-between figure there. Typically, there's little focus on infancy or childhood of these figures, so we don't know what their growing up was like, or we don't know very much about it. And then there's some other various common features that we might identify in these stories. So kind of cutting to the chase here, is Samson's birth a biblical hero story, or does Samson's birth follow maybe some of the rough patterns that we might expect? So we do have infertility. We do have this annunciation type scene. There's very little focus, if any, on Samson's upbringing or his childhood. We just immediately jump to his adulthood. So if you came up with this list or a similar list, you might be able to argue that Samson's birth story is a biblical, is the story of the birth of a biblical hero. And so what does this do for us as readers? And this is where it maybe gets even a little more speculative, but I would say that for us as readers, we come into the Samson story, and if we don't know how it ends, or we haven't read it in a long time, we would probably say we have big hopes for Samson. We would say, wow, this guy is going to be sort of extra special and cool. And I guess depending on your reading of Samson, you might conclude that, yeah, he was extra special or cool, or you might conclude that, wow, what a total disappointment this guy turned out to be. He started off with such big expectations, and he ends tragically, and that is sort of the element that shakes us up as we're reading the story. So what are some criticisms of structuralism? And this is outlined in the section by Dunn and the Yee book, but just to go over these briefly. At the end of a structural reading, sometimes you just ask the question, well, so what? And I will admit that sometimes I come to this conclusion as well. So if I am doing an analysis of a biblical text and somebody has pointed out that, well, this line of the psalm has 9 accents and this line has 8 and then the next line has 9, I think, wow, that's so great that you've spent all this time analyzing the accents of this psalm. But I get to the end and I say, does this really help me interpret the psalm? And my honest answer is that often it really doesn't help me that much. I read the psalm the same, whether there seems to be a pattern of accentuation or not. Now, some people are super into this, so I don't want to kind of rain on their parade, but I'm just saying for me, that form of structuralism, seeing that structure, isn't really all that helpful. There's also, I won't go into the structural system, but many biblical scholars like to identify what are called chiasms, or sometimes called chiasms or hiasms in biblical texts, because they sort of form an X-like structure, and where the beginning and the end are the same, and then they sort of have other similar passages as you get to sort of a middle of a passage. And oftentimes I read those too, and I think, yeah, this is true, seems true to me, sounds right, seems really, I don't know, interesting at some level, but doesn't help me all that much as an interpreter. Sometimes it might, but not always that often. So identifying structures in and of itself, some people have said that, yeah, but so what? Does this really help me? Some people see it as too scientific. So if we're looking at structure in a story, are we just reducing stories to this set of common elements? Or, you know, are we really just reading the same story over and over and over again? And while I think that is maybe a good critique, I don't think most people, when they hear similar stories, even really realize that they're similar. So I remember the very first time when I outlined some of these common elements of hero stories, and I compared them to the Moses story in an undergraduate class, I posed the question, does this idea of abandonment, finding your ultimate true identity, and then kind of coming, returning to your own people, does that sound like anything else you've ever heard? And the first response I got back was, yes, every Disney movie I have ever seen. And not being a Disney movie aficionado, like I maybe should be, that answer kind of surprised me. But this student saw that that element is just so familiar to most Disney movies. And again, not having seen many Disney movies, I can't tell you if this is true or false. So you have to judge that on your own. But I don't think people stop going to Disney movies just because the structures are often the same. because each story also has its individual elements. Each story is still different enough that it can be identified as something new or some sort of different setting. And probably these common structural elements are subconscious. We don't even really know that they're there until somebody actually points them out to us. The flip side of this critique is that perhaps structuralism is not scientific enough. So you'll notice when I was talking about the Moses story as a hero story, I sort of pulled out specific elements from Dundas's list, and I said, look, the Moses story follows some of these things that Dundas has identified in his article. And for some people, and sometimes even for myself, this does, seem like a little bit too much mix and match. So we're maybe pulling out what seems to fit in the structure that fits our reading or our comparison, and ignoring everything else that doesn't fit. And or that similarities may lie solely in the eyes of the beholder, that it's not really objective, that it's just sort of ourselves putting our ideas about similarity onto the text that maybe really aren't there. So too much like, I don't know if you remember old refrigerator magnet poetry where you had a bunch of words that were refrigerator magnets and you took the words and you constructed a poem out of them just based on the available elements. And sometimes people say, well, people are just sort of taking available elements, seeing, yeah, look, this is the same, this is the same. But really, is there enough similarity in two stories that are being compared to say they are actually structurally the same? Or are they just somewhat similar? To me, stories often have what there was a philosopher of language by the name of Ludwig Wittgenstein who talked about language and stories having a family resemblance. And I've always thought that this is a good analogy, where we might be able to take two people from the same family, maybe a mother and a daughter, and we see them side by side, and we say, wow, you know, these two women have the same eyes, the same hair, their facial features are very similar. If we look at them right next to each other, we can see that these two people are related. But yet, that relationship is still... that similarity is still a little vague to us. We don't exactly see why they look the same, but we just know standing and just staring at them that, yes, these two people are related. And I think sometimes stories work the same way. Once we set them right next to each other, we say, wow, yeah, there are a lot of similarities to this story, and we can see them as sort of a family resemblance. They're not exactly the same stories, but they do have enough commonality that they seem to draw on each other. So structural approaches, how can they be useful, or why might they be useful? First of all, they can help us identify intertextuality. And I've talked about intertextuality before in this course, and you probably all know that I am a huge fan of this way of reading the Bible. So if we see stories that are similar, they might help us bring these two stories together and compare them. So up until now, I've asked you to look at the story of Yael as compared to the anonymous woman of Judges 9. So both use common household goods to kill off threatening men. And so I think that those similarities, to me, are not, you know, accidental similarities. Now, can I prove that? I probably can't prove that. But to me, when I read these two stories together, this helps me understand both stories in a way. And once I've read them together, I kind of can't read them apart. And it's not just that the stories are similar. Oftentimes, we can identify the fact of how the stories are different. And sometimes the meaning of the difference is what is surprising to us as readers. So I think way earlier on in the course, I talked about the Bible having many stories that sort of more or less begin, a man had two sons. And I started off by saying that the story of Cain and Abel, there's a story of two sons, things happen, and they end violently. Then I mentioned that there's also the story of Jacob and Esau in the book of Genesis, where we have two sons, there's a lot of friction between the two, but the story does not end violently. And to my mind, the reason that the story does not end violently is because Jacob can see the face of God in the face of his brother. So that image or that intervention in the story is what, to me, short circuits maybe the violence that we might expect in this story. So I see similarities between lots of stories in the biblical text. Whether you see them, I think, is somewhat up to you. But sometimes they're so similar that I can hardly think that that's an accident. Also talked about last week the story of Jephthah and Saul as sort of being two common stories of leaders that make rash judgments or rash oaths in the midst of battle, and how those two stories turn out in that case differently. So whether that's a category of story or not is up to you, but I think that this really helps us read the biblical text in a way that we might not have thought of up until this point of time. So we read and compare stories. It also helps us think about the Bible and traditionality. And what I mean here is the Bible being a set, particularly the narratives, or maybe the laws and the others, the Psalms and other poetry as well, as stories or literary elements that circulated among people before they were written down. So it helps us think about the life of the Bible prior to the Bible being actually written and ultimately then passed along as a written text. So as I mentioned earlier, the story of Samson contains a lot of elements that seem kind of folkloristic, like a story that would be told in a way that would circulate among people orally. And so there's an orality in this text that maybe helps us think about the life of the Bible before the Bible was actually written down. And then I think it helps us realize how the Bible achieves its interconnectedness. So because the Bible has this element of intertextuality, I think, this is just my opinion, that this is one way that the Bible achieves its coherent whole, if you will, in that the books are interconnected with each other by these common elements between stories. And then finally, as for my personal conviction about structuralism, I think God often comes to us in familiar forms and patterns, because this is, for whatever reason, the way that we relate to stories, the way we relate to literary works, and the whole fact that they come to us in a sense that might sound like, oh, here's the birth of a hero. That's not an accident, and that helps us develop expectations about the text. It tells us what we're about to hear before we hear it. And so I personally don't see this as a problem in reading the Bible. Actually, I see it as just another way that God helps us through the biblical text and helps us in our process of interpretation. You don't have to agree with that, but that's my viewpoint. So I hope this has been a helpful introduction to the idea of structuralism. Again, if the readings that are assigned for this week seem a little dense, I apologize for that, but I hope that this lecture has helped you come to these ideas in a more sort of foundational way, and that perhaps you will be able to apply these ideas as you continue to read the Bible in this course and beyond this course as well. Thank you so much for listening, and hope you're having a great week. Talk to you soon.